Tu es en stage ici, c'est normal que je te critique, non?
Oui.
Je veux juste que tu apprennes une chose pendant ton stage, une seule. Tu peux arrêter avec ta machine? Je veux que tu apprennes à faire un bon diagnostic. Si tu te laisses émouvoir par la souffrance du patient, tu perds la distance, tu fais un mauvais diagnostic.
Je t'ai dit, ça a été plus fort que moi.
Si tu veux être un bon médecin, tu dois être plus fort que tes émotions.
The Dardenne brothers, Jean-Pierre and Luc, are very famous filmmakers from a small industrial town in the area of Liège, Belgium. They make films in a singular fashion, something like the Coen brothers in our country. Not that their films are similar, but the same style of making the films. The setting is always one they know and grew up in, and where they still live.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. You know, we went to live there when we were 12, and even when we didn't live there, it was a place where we used to go. So it is definitely a part of our childhood.
C'est aussi l'endroit où on a tourné la plupart de nos documentaires. On n'a pas fait beaucoup de documentaires, mais les gens qu'on a filmés, qui sont dans nos documentaires, on les a filmés aussi dans cette ville.
It's also where we shot most of our documentaries. We didn't make a lot of documentaries, but the people that we filmed were from this town, this city.
Alors on a commencé à repeupler cette ville avec les personnages de nos fictions.
So we started to repopulate this city with the characters from our fiction films.
Each film is a small gem, a handcrafted piece of art. La Promesse, Le Fille, L'Enfant are absolute must-sees. The Boy with a Bike, 2 Days in One Night are recent jewels. You should see them all. But how do they work? How do they put together these remarkable movies that are so intimate and so personal? Luc explained in an interview with the Paris Review. First of all the actors have the script before the rehearsal starts. The main actors have the whole script. The supporting actors have portions of the script. We rehearse pretty much the way we shoot. We rehearse in sequence, and we really do rehearse with the script. We stay close to what's on the page. The modifications that occur throughout the rehearsal process, sometimes with the complicity of the actors and sometimes not, is really a process of simplification, of tearing down what we initially start with. But essentially, the end result is really close. He does emphasize that they do something very special. They shoot in sequence, beginning to end, and they don't vary, as most filmmakers do. Now, listen and look at the faces of these brothers who made this film, full of warmth, intelligence, humor, and sorrow.
Qui continue à évoluer, mais qui est toujours un peu dans la même veine.
Was there a discussion where you said this is the thing?
La grande discussion qu'on a eue, c'est quand on a fait La Promesse.
No, the big discussion that we had was when we shot The Promise.
C'est là qu'on a, entre guillemets, trouvé notre méthode de travail.
That's where, you know, quote unquote, we found our work method.
Mm-hmm. Que le film est devenu notre film, alors qu'avant pas.
That's when the film became our film, and prior to that, it wasn't.
Mm-hmm. On a écrit le scénario nous-mêmes.
We wrote the screenplay ourselves.
On a éliminé beaucoup de médiation technique.
We eliminated a lot of technical mediation, you know, machinery.
On a fait le plan de travail nous-mêmes parce que on a décidé de tourner dans la continuité.
Okay, we set up the work plan ourselves because we decided we wanted to shoot in continuity.
Mm-hmm. Ça veut dire que si on commence le film, premier plan de la première scène dans tel décor, et qu'on n'est pas content de ce qu'on a fait et qu'on s'en rend compte 2 semaines après, on garde le décor et on revient tourner dedans.
It means that if we shoot the first scene in a set, but then we only realize 2 weeks later that we're not happy with that first scene, mm-hmm. then we come back to that, we keep the set, we come back to that original set and we reshoot.
Et c'est ça qui coûte un peu cher pour nos films, c'est qu'on garde les décors et on les rééclaire une deuxième fois alors qu'on ne devait plus y revenir.
And that's what's expensive with our films because mm-hmm. we keep the sets and we keep where the lighting. Vous gardez les lumières en place, vous savez?
On garde la structure.
We keep the basic structure of the lighting and come back so that we can come back to it.
Donc Et alors, avec les acteurs, c'est très intéressant parce que les personnages, le scénario évolue et ils se nourrissent de leur évolution et nous, on a plus d'audace pour changer les choses.
Okay, and it's very interesting with the acting process because they nourish themselves as the film evolves. And so then we have more elements with which to work with as the film progresses.
On sent mieux les personnages, et je crois que pour les acteurs aussi, ils sentent mieux. Et donc, on a plus de liberté. On dit, tiens, ce qu'on voulait faire, maintenant qu'on a vu comment ça se passait dans le cadre, comment on a déjà filmé ça, on les revoit le week-end, etc., on revoit nos rushs, on se dit, ah, maintenant, je crois que c'est ça qu'il faut faire, on peut le faire.
You know, when they start to have a better sense of the characters, and so as you know, maybe on the weekend where we're watching the rushes, and we say, oh, gee, you know, now that I see how this works in this frame, etc., you know, this it would work better to do X, Y, and Z the way you know in the previous scene this way, and then they can come back with more. It gives us more freedom to be able to work.
Et il y a plusieurs films où on a trouvé la fin du film en faisant. On n'avait pas trouvé aux répétitions. On l'a trouvé justement parce qu'on tournait et là on a senti qu'on pouvait faire une fin différente.
And there are several films where we found the ending while we were shooting when we hadn't found it in rehearsals prior.
For this film, The Unknown Girl, they must have sat down one evening and asked each other, how does a person live a morally honest life? Surely thus they came up with this film. If ever a film built itself logically and without deviation on stepping stones of incident and thought that lead to a deliberated answer to this often asked question. Here it is. This is a film about ethics, about doing what you feel is right, about living what you believe. That means it is a film about courage and commitment. People who live this way are very rare in my experience. I found this film extraordinary in its clarity, simplicity, and direct message. Let's listen to the brothers at Cannes last spring, where for the first time, one of their films opened to negative reaction. This film. In an unprecedented move, they withdrew the film from further showing, re-edited, and what we see today has been highly praised by most critics. The New Yorker review reflects my feelings perfectly. Please read that full review at the end of the video when you get a chance. I think that this is the most impressive movie I saw this year. Here are the brothers answering questions about the film.
But it was impossible to develop the story, and we gave up the story. And it was because we met by chance Adèle Haenel, and after that we spoke together, and we said maybe with Adèle, with this young face, naive, innocent, maybe it will be possible to tell our story. And how with this naive face, how is it possible to change the others? Because she doesn't have a hidden agenda. Because she's young, she's innocent, but a good innocence, not stupidity. Yes, that's it. Because that's the reason. Because we chose this young character.
How many times do we ask ourselves, but what can I do? I cannot sacrifice everything for people I don't even know. This is the film to watch. A young doctor who asks herself just that and then shows us what we can and should do. We don't have to, but we see someone who actually does. The brothers themselves have really been doing this for years with their simple, slow-paced moral tales. An unusual pair, since they did remain in that small Belgian city where they were born and have made their films there that champion the overlooked, the oppressed, the working man who increasingly seems to have no work. All these films are serious, but they're not dark and heavy. They deal with humanity as it is and leaves the viewer with positive feelings. They could be everyone's version of the wise older uncles who tell modern moral stories that are simple yet fascinating. They are held in the highest esteem in the film world. Every film is honored, usually, and is cherished for the detail, care, and unswerving drive for a look at the, of course, in quotes, truth of our modern world. So, in The Unknown Girl, they take a stand and show us just how we can live different lives. We must think. We're supposed to care if someone dies and no one else cares. We must look at our actions, make a decision, and change our lives. If we feel strongly and passionately that we see the right thing to do, then we must make difficult choices. Jenny, the young doctor who's finishing a temporary fill-in position at a neighborhood government clinic before she moves on to a prestigious practice across town, is faced with herself. She's made a bad decision. She has ignored the bell of the door after the close of the practice one evening.
On n'ouvre pas, on a déjà dépassé d'une heure. Oui, excusez-moi, je devais... Ah, d'accord. Oui, très bien. J'en ai encore pour un quart d'heure. Parfait. Je me réjouis, très bien. À tout à l'heure. Quelqu'un qui sonne une heure après la fermeture, c'est quelqu'un qui se fiche de notre fatigue.
C'était peut-être une urgence?
Si c'était une urgence, la personne aurait sonné une deuxième fois.
Because she wants to appear decisive and in control to her young intern. This results in a young woman's death. Jenny's life begins to unravel because she allows it to. She feels guilty and follows the guilt where it leads. This alone is a path most of us avoid on a daily basis. Step by step, we watch and hold our breath. We think to ourselves, no, just move on. You're asking too much of yourself. But she is resolute. This is not a movie you will see often. This is not a subject that many of us wrestle with on an extended basis. Mostly, we just move along with our lives and rationalize our reasons for doing so. Slowly and deftly, a case appears for Jenny to look in the mirror and ask, who am I? What is the right thing to do? How far can I, must I, pursue something that could easily be ignored? Jenny seems to make her decision in a moment. She never wavers. She pushes on when most of us would say, enough. The Unknown Girl emphasizes phone calls, intercoms, and voicemails, doors being buzzed open or not, to recognize that in the digital age of all forms of communication are crucial, but nothing can replace the power of face-to-face communication. The absence of one such interaction provides the film with its fateful, inciting incident, giving Jenny's determination and her activism a really haunted quality. Every other conversation has an element of subdued urgency founded in real human concern. As the film unfolds, we are given a view of the usual cast of characters in all our lives. Philandering husband, poverty-stricken older people, conniving policeman, protective mother, the logical, honest, working professional, the young and confused apprentice. All the complications of the world that everyone must deal with. But here in this film, our lead character looks, thinks, decides what is right, and does it. In the initial criticism of the movie, the brothers themselves were stung at Cannes, where it was soundly rejected by many as not well portrayed by the lead actress. In my view, her performance is perfectly calibrated. She's a calm, thinking person, totally sincere and firm in her feelings. The performance of the lead actress is steely, easily mistaken for passionless. But this is exactly the type of behavior we could expect from such a person. She is single-minded, determined, and dedicated. She cannot live with herself with any other course of action. It's sort of a murder mystery, but with each clue, with each new discovery of what happened after the bell was not answered, the door was not opened on the night that changes Jenny's world, we instinctively feel what she's feeling. Her resolve is humbling. We start to say to ourselves, well, she's going too far. This is unnecessary. But as the Dardenne brothers see life now, with all its easy moral exit doors that do open for most people, Jenny has no choice. We start to think of the people we know who perhaps have made the same sort of decision. One amusing sequence at the Cannes press conference was the reaction of the brothers to a very long, involved, serious question about why Jenny wore the same particular coat she wore. What did that mean? Did that mean she wanted to distance herself from her patients, etc., etc.? Both the brothers were visibly and amusingly annoyed and commented that sometimes viewers might overthink films. Jenny's dilemmas were far greater and of more importance than her winter coat selection. Luke remarked to the audience that they chose the coat because it was cold in Belgium in the winter and she would be wearing a coat. Hopefully, Jenny will stay in your mind as she has in mine. Sort of, what would Jenny do, maybe? Naturally, it's really what would the Dardenne brothers think of for something. How would they look at it? How would they turn it into a film that seems so effortless? Most definitely, don't worry about what they're wearing. The graceful final moments of The Unknown Girl evoke the parting words of Jewish chemist and writer Primo Levi at the end of his wonderful book, Ex Libris. He said, quote, "The manner in which we make our lives, that defines us." Indeed, Jenny is seen helping one of her aging patients to the clinic examining room as the film closes. We watch and we see Jenny is defining herself.